place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more.
Good morning, Lighthouse. Would you stand to your feet this morning? Let's worship.
And now I'm ready for whatever you want to do. Your presence is an open door. We want you, Lord, like never before. Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before. In every season, your grace has been enough. And I'm believing the best is yet to come.
I know.
I know.
the church today, Greg Rosinski want to meet with all the men in the sanctuary. Just a little discussion and the fishing trip that's coming up. So if you can make it, come out. Tonight at 5 o'clock, the A-team will be meeting. And then we're going to have pie after that. Pie. Come on and find out what kind of pie. Amen. Amen. And also, this Wednesday at 6:30, our last Awana training will be going on. So those are on the team. Just know you got to be there for the last one at least so we could know what's going on. Amen? Amen. 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 We're just going to pray and just ask the Lord, just continue to have his way, God. Lord, I just pray, Lord, that breakthrough will come through today, Lord God, even as at Mount Cherizim, Lord God. Lord God, you will bring us through, Lord God, those things that's been standing in the way. Lord God, we thank you that you're a way maker, that you are God who breakthrough. You're the master of breakthrough. Lord God, we just thank you today that we'll see your goodness in the land of the living. Lord, we bless you today, God. Even as we go forward, Holy Spirit, have your way in this house. Amen. Amen.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In the darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend.
Running out.
And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. Sing it out this morning, church, all my life. And all my life you have been faithful. You have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. Cause your goodness is running after, it's running after. Is running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Oh, your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running.
Breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save, is worthy, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. The name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever be. We live for you.
Build my life. last week, if you were here, I shared that Jesus has been laying unity. He's really been speaking that into my life and how to unite with other people and how we as a body can unite with one another. And I had said that my ankle had hurt, and I was talking about how when one part of the body suffers, the whole body suffers. Because if you've ever hurt one part of your body, you know that you've never realized how much you need that body part. And all of us in here are that. But another thing that happened, my ankle hurt on my right leg, but now my knee hurts on my left because I've been using my left leg too much. And the Lord was really showing me that in something that seems so simple and non-spiritual as that, God still uses it. But he's showing me that sometimes we as a body, if you are not well, the rest of the body has to suffer with you and pick up whatever it is that you're unable to do, and that's okay. Sometimes we need to rest and we need to heal, but it is imperative that you heal, because if you don't, the rest of the body will start to hurt. You are that important as a person. And I know there is somebody in here right now, maybe somebody's in here right now, you are not operating at 100% like Jesus Christ wants you to do. And you might not know how to get well, because I don't always know how to get well, but I do know that it happens when we surrender ourselves to Jesus Christ. And when people were healed in the Bible, Jesus came up to them and said, "What do you want? Do you want to be well?" And we have to check ourselves sometimes and find out, God, do I want to be well? And I'm telling you right now, the goodness of God is chasing after you this morning. And if you are not well, he wants to do that for you right now. He wants to make you whole. But it can only come when you surrender before him and you give it all over to him right now. And God, that is what we do. As a body, Lord, we pray for our hurting brothers and sisters, and we ask that you would make them well so that we can rejoice together as one. You have also called us to rejoice, and we celebrate the unity and the wholeness that only you can give. Lord, you are worthy of it all. Deserve the glory. Day and night, night and day.
everything that we have is yours. Everything that we hang on to for ourselves is in reality yours. Everything that we so desperately try to hold on to, you tell us, if you really want to gain, to give it away. Give it all away. Just give it away. Just let it go. Just release it. Lord, I thank you that you're teaching us that. I thank you, Lord, that as we grow in you and as we grow in maturity in you, we realize the more that we give of ourselves, the more we give of our finances, the more we give of our time, the more we give of who we are, of our talents, we just gain so much more back because it draws us into proximity with you. It draws us to you, Lord. Continue to teach us that, Lord. And God, I pray that as we give of our finances today, just a small thing, just one of those things, it's not even, that's just such a small thing of who we are. But as we give of that today, we ask, Lord God, that it would just please you. That it would put a smile on your face, that as we give cheerfully, Lord, realizing that no matter what, we cannot outgive you. No matter what we give, no matter how much we give, we cannot outgive you. Whether it be the widow's mite or whether it would be the millionaire's million, it's not going to matter. It's, we cannot outgive you. And I pray, Lord God, that would be in our hearts today. As we just give of what you have given us, Lord, because it is all yours.
Seated if you need to this morning. I really just feel moved of the Spirit of God this morning to pray for the sick. We usually do this on Sunday night at our pie, people to come because it takes up time in the service sometimes. But let me tell you something, when God is moving and the angels troubling the water, so to speak, that's the time to get in. So if you're here this morning and you need special prayer for healing in your body, I'd just like for you to come and just stand in the front here. We're going to pray for you. If I could have the elders of the church, the deacons, join me. We're going to take a moment for special prayer for the sick today. If you're sick in your physical body this morning and you'd like to be anointed with oil and prayer, as the scripture says, just come. While we're praying, if you would just extend your hand this way and pray for us as we're praying, sing and worship with the worship team. Just pray and get in the attitude of worship this morning and ask God and believe God for miracles. Amen? Jesus said, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. So this morning we're asking God for the miraculous and we're seeking Him. He said, you will find me when you seek me with your whole heart. So will you give your whole heart this morning to God and seek Him for healing for your brothers and sisters in Christ this morning? In Jesus' name.
Day and night and day, let it sing.
my worries in your love, and casting every care on you. I have carried them enough. We're not alone here within His love. Emmanuel, He is still with us.
Here in the presence of the
here in the presence of the Lord. Mercy is falling. Lift up your hands, receive it now. Here in the presence of the
you're more.
thank you so much for your prayers for the saints today. I believe you'll be hearing some testimonies. Thank you for your patience. If the ushers will come forward and just collect the offering this morning. I just invite the ushers to come forward at this time. Father, just bless your offering. Bless your people as they give today to you. Thank you that you are faithful to us, that you heal us. Lord, I know there are people here this morning who need the healing in their finances. They're struggling, God. There's wounds there, and they need your help. And we just pray, God, for your special grace on their life, Lord, as they look to you in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. God bless you as you give today. Thank you, worship team. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. While the ushers are serving you today, if you'll open up your Bible apps and turn to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. Whew, I'm really excited this morning. I'm nervous about preaching today because I just know how important God's word is and the truth that I have to share with you today has the potential to radically change your life. I can't do that. The person beside you can't do that, but God can do that. And he wants to do that. And so I pray that you would just open your hearts this morning and open your minds. In fact, I want to pray for you. And when you found that text, will you just stand up to your feet and we'll all read it together. John chapter 14. It'll be up on the screen here for you as well if you don't have a Bible. I'm reading from the New International Version. John chapter 14. In John chapter 14, Jesus is speaking to his disciples, and it's a very long discourse recorded for us here. This is at the Passover. This is before Jesus is going to be he's going to be betrayed and crucified. He's going to die. He's going to be resurrected. He's going to ascend to heaven. And here at this meal, he speaks to his beloved 12 that are surrounding him that have been with him for 3 years. And he begins by telling them in the beginning of the chapter, "Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." Turn to your neighbor and say, "Don't be troubled." Yeah. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there's many mansions. In fact, I'm going to prepare one just for you, that where I am going, you may go, come also. And he goes on to talk about that, which puts some trouble, which is why he told him don't be troubled, because what I'm fixing to tell you is going to shake you up a little bit. And the disciples were, "What do you mean you're leaving, Jesus? What do you mean? Where are you going? And we don't know where you're going. How do we know how to get there?" And Jesus responded by one of the most powerful statements in the scripture. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Jesus is the answer to everything. Yeah? And so, and then he begins to tell them, and let's read it for ourselves, beginning in verse 15. He says, "If you love me, you will obey what I command, and here's what's going to happen. I'm going to ask the Father, and he will give you another comforter to be with you forever." Hey, so Jesus says, "I'm fixing to leave, but don't worry. Don't be afraid, because there's somebody that's going to take my place." And he calls him the counselor or the comforter. And then in the next verse he says, "The Spirit," notice the capital S, this is a title of the Holy Ghost, "the Spirit of truth, The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be, future tense, in you. I'm not going to leave you as orphans. I will come to you. You say amen? All right, now let's go down to verse 25. He continues to talk to them. Verse 25, he says, all of this I have spoken while I am still with you. But now he talks about the Holy Spirit again. The Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Isn't that awesome? And then in chapter 16, same conversation, same speech, later on, he says, verse 7, I tell you the truth, it is for your good that I am leaving. Unless I go away, the Counselor will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, this is what he will do. He will do what? Convict. He will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin and righteousness and judgment. In regard to sin, because men do not believe in me. In regard to righteousness, because I am going to the Father where you can see me no longer. And in regard to judgment, because the prince of this world, that's Satan, now stands condemned. I have much more to say to you, more that you can bear right now. But he, the Spirit of truth, here he is again, when he comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak about himself. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will bring glory to me by taking what is mine, that glory, and making it known to you. Thank you, Lord, for your word today. Just open the hearts and minds of everybody. Arrest them right now, God. So whatever struggles they're having, whatever they're preoccupied with, just erase it right now in Jesus' name. They can just soak in every word that comes out of my mouth this morning for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you're seated. New sermon this morning entitled Ghost. And of course, when we talk about ghost, we're talking about the Holy Ghost. The only ghost, right? And we're gonna say a lot in this series of sermons. It's gonna be several weeks. But let me just start right up by saying that when we talk about the Holy Ghost, we're talking about the Holy Spirit. The terms Holy Ghost and Holy Spirit are the same. Ghost is an old English word that has kind of morphed into some type of like ghoulish term for us, you know? When you hear the word ghost, you don't think of Jesus, right? You think of ghoulish things. And so today, that word is morphed, and we prefer the word spirit. And so we used to always call the third person of the Godhead the Holy Ghost, but now we call him the Holy Spirit. But when we talk about Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, we're talking about the same thing. Now, most Christians know that the Holy Ghost is a part of the Trinity because we've heard it all of our lives. Whether you're Protestant or Catholic, if you're anywhere under Christendom, Orthodox Christianity, you've heard all of your life, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost, right? And with that, I think that we know who God the Father is, right? We know that God is the creator who sits on enthroned over the universe and sustainer of all things. We know who God the Father is, and when we close our eyes, we have some kind of mental image, even though we've never seen him, of a person like sitting on a throne, some light, some type of substance that's there that is God Almighty, Yahweh, right? And I think that we know who Jesus is because Jesus is God who came in the flesh, right? Who became among us, became one of us in order to die and give his body as a propitiation, an atoning sacrifice for our sins. And we know that he came and was born of a virgin and lived. And we know that he fulfilled the mission God sent him to the earth for. And we know that he died. And 3 days he rose. On the third day, he ascended to the right hand of God, where he is now making intercession for us. Jesus is not here. Jesus is in heaven, right? And he's making intercession for us. And we know that Jesus is coming back again to rule and reign on the earth. And of course, we all know what Jesus looks like because we've seen his picture. We have this, we understand Jesus, you know, who he is, and the Gospels just tells us so much about his life. But who's the Holy Ghost? You close your eyes, you get an image of the Holy Ghost. Do you see a person? Do you see, what do you see? And we've heard so much about God the Father and Jesus, but so little has been taught about the Holy Spirit. And so, who is the Holy Ghost? That's what I want to address this morning. And I have found pretty much that Christians fall into one of two camps. By the way, welcome to those who are watching online. So glad you're with us today. So, the two camps that I feel a lot of Christians fall into when it comes to understanding the Holy Ghost. In one camp, you have those who like really focus on the Holy Ghost, and like their whole life is about the Holy Ghost, and they have a lot of misunderstandings about the Holy Ghost. On the other side, on this camp, we have Christians who really truthfully know a lot about Jesus, but they don't know very much at all about the Holy Ghost. Now, I grew up in a traditional Pentecostal home and church, and so I grew up in this camp here. And in this camp here, in the house, in the church that I grew up in, until I was 18 or 17 years old, guess what? It was all about the Holy Ghost. I mean, the Holy Ghost, we prayed in the Spirit. We talked about the Holy Ghost. We prayed to the Holy Ghost. We involved the Holy Ghost. It was all about the Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost. It was the Holy Ghost. I mean, we just lived, eat, drank, and breathed the Holy Ghost. And I had these ideas that were put into me, that and that's a good thing, you know, because the Holy Ghost, we want the Holy Ghost. But some of the things that I was taught was kind of like twisted about the Holy Ghost. And with this emphasis on the Holy Ghost, there was a lot of things that were attributed to the Holy Ghost that scripturally maybe shouldn't have been attributed to the Holy Ghost. And a lot of legalism and stuff like that. And for example, in the home that I grew up in, it's like if you're a lady and you get baptized in the Holy Ghost, your hair grows long. And it turns into a bun up on top of your head. And they had this bun, this big bun, we call it a beehive. You know, a beehive hairdo. My mom wore a beehive hairdo for years. You know, there was this time. And so I just associated that in my mind, you know, as being something that was a part of the Holy. If you're baptized the Holy Ghost, this is the way you wear your hair if you're a woman. So, now, you know, when the millennials came around and the guys started wearing little man buns, you know what I'm talking about? I wish Pastor Sean was here. I could, you know, and little man buns. So I just assumed I see a man with a man bun. Oh, he's got the Holy Ghost, right? He's got the Holy Ghost. He's got a bun on his head. Yeah, I'm making light of that. But in our home, it was nothing to make light of, right? It was very serious. But even though I came out of that, I learned as I went into ministry and went into the world, I learned that what the type of home that I was raised in was just a really, really small, tiny portion of the Christian community. That really, when I came out in the world, I discovered that the vast majority of Christians were in this camp. They don't know anything hardly about the Holy Ghost. And so that's what this sermon series is about. If you're in this camp and you know everything there is about the Holy Ghost, then just say amen while I'm preaching the series and help me preach. Because all these people I hear don't know anything about the Holy Ghost, and that's what I want to tell them. I want to tell them about the Holy Spirit. Are you still with me? Say amen. So, let's start with the basics of Orthodox Christian theology, formed and established by the apostles and the early church fathers who grappled in the first couple of hundred years after Pentecost about, first of all, who Jesus was, and forming a theology about that, and then about who the Holy Ghost was and what was his part in the Trinity. And the first thing I want you to understand this morning, and remember the video we showed the last 2 weeks about the kids downstairs, they asked him who the Holy Ghost was? Remember that? That was so cute. And Michelle's son was telling us what he had learned at home, that the Holy Ghost had pointed ears and a big nose. And, right? Totally embarrassed, his mom and dad. I'm just teasing. So, right, we all laughed because kids, you know, they have this creative mind and imagination. I love kids, talking to kids. But when they ask a question, who is the Holy Ghost? All the kids said out loud, God! They knew, good job, Michelle, they knew the Holy Ghost was God, right? I love that. But most people don't understand that. The Holy Ghost is God. You say, well, you say the Holy Ghost is God, but you mean like he's like the force of God, like this breath or this wind or something that blows, and that's what the presence of God. What do you mean that the Holy Ghost is God? And what we mean by that is that the Holy Ghost is the third person of the triune Godhead. God is one. There's not three gods. There's one God, right? One God. And God has revealed himself to us in the Word of God in three separate personhoods that have personalities and characteristics, and they are unity, they are co-equal, they are co-eternal. They existed together before there was time or space or anything, and they will exist together forever. There is not one that is less than the other. They are equally important and play a role in the Godhead. And the Holy Ghost plays a critical role, especially for us who live on the earth right now in the Godhead. First of all, his name reveals this to us, right? The Old Testament, the Hebrew word for spirit is ruach, and it means breath or wind of air, but not just a regular breath, but it means a violent wind, a hard or rushing wind, like in Acts chapter 2. There was a rushing, mighty wind. That was showing, going back to the Jews, ruach, Hebrew, this wasn't just breath. This was holy breath. This was a holy wind. This was a God wind, that sound that they heard. We see this in the very first of the Bible when God comes down in the Garden of Eden and he forms man from the dust of the earth, creates him, and then he breathes into him the breath of life. That Hebrew word is ruach. And when he did that, man became a living being. So that's that ruach that is there. In the New Testament, the Greek word is pneuma, which also means breath or wind, but not just a normal wind, but a breath of life. So when I talk about the language itself, we're not simply saying that the Holy Ghost is a wind of God or a force of God, but he is a person of God. And when we are first open the Bible, we are introduced to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Ghost is right there in the beginning in Genesis chapter 1. Let's turn there together. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep. And here it is. The Spirit of God. There he is. That's the Holy Ghost. Was hovering over the waters. And then later in the chapter, God comes down. He says, let us create. Who is us? And there's the Godhead. There's the Trinity that's there working together. And we get a little bit of understanding from the very first verses of the Bible about who the Holy Ghost is as far as his role. Because in creation, we see the beginning of what will take place throughout the rest of the Bible until the end of time. And what we see is that God in the Trinity wills it, Jesus, who is the Word, speaks it, and the Holy Spirit is the one who does it. He's the active force. God in heaven and creation willing. Colossians 2, Jesus said, Colossians 2 says that Jesus spoke all things, created all things that be. So Jesus speaks, let there be light, and there was light. Let there be trees, and there was trees. But Jesus spoke it, but it was the Holy Spirit who's here hovering over the waters, just waiting on the Word to come forth. And when the Word comes forth, the Holy Spirit enacts and makes the trees. So the Holy Spirit is that active, creative part of the Trinity that does what Jesus speaks, what God wills. You see that? And you see this all through as we go through the Bible. We see this as a part of the role of the Holy Spirit. So he is that acting part of the Godhead at work in the earth and in our lives right now. You need to understand that. I want you to get that. This is why it's so important that you understand the Holy Ghost. God the Father in heaven. Jesus the Son in heaven. Where's the Holy Ghost? He's here. He's not just with us. He is within us. So if the Holy Ghost is a part of God that is with us every day, we need to know the Holy Ghost. Amen? We really need to understand the Holy Ghost. So in John chapter 14 in our text, Jesus told his disciples he was going to go to the Father. But he would not leave them alone. He'd already promised them, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. Get this, John 14, Jesus said, I will never leave you, right? And then what did Jesus do? He left them. He left them. He did. He ascended up into heaven. They watched him go. He said, I'll be back. He left them. But Jesus is trying to tell us and his disciples in John 14, I'm going to the Father, but I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm going to be with you. How is Jesus going to be with us when he's in heaven? I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. He's with you now. You felt him. You've seen him work. You know who he is. You've seen the anointing of the Spirit working in my life. But listen, he is not going to just be on me. Now the Holy Ghost is going to be on you. He's not just going to be on you, he's going to be in you. And the things that you see me do, you also shall do, because now you have the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Everything Jesus did, he did by the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Right? When in his baptism, when he began his public ministry, the Holy Spirit descends from heaven upon him, lights upon him in the form of a dove, right? And God speaks and says, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him, hear him. Why hear? Because he's the Word. And what he speaks is life. So hear the word of the Lord. And Jesus starts his ministry, opens a scroll to Isaiah, his first sermon in the synagogue, and says, the Spirit of the Lord, the Holy Ghost, is upon me. For he has anointed me to do what? To preach the gospel to the poor, to bring deliverance to the captive, to set liberty those who are free, to give sight to the blind, to raise the dead. Everything that Jesus did, he did under the anointing of the Holy Ghost, because the Holy Ghost is the doer. He's the doer. He's the active. He's the creative part of the doer. And so when Jesus speaks, the Holy Ghost goes and works, and it happens. Hey, it happens. It happens. And Jesus said, I am going to send the Holy Ghost. That anointing that came upon me, when he worked through me, you see him, he's been with you, but he is soon going to be in you. Woo! And you're going to be doing the things that I have been doing. You're going to continue my ministry with my anointing. It's the anointing of the Holy Ghost. You need to know the Holy Ghost and who he is. We need the Holy Ghost. Now notice in our text as we read that Jesus does not call the Holy Ghost an it. The Holy Ghost is not an it. Stop calling the Holy Ghost an it. It's a he. He's a person. Five times in these two verses, Jesus refers to the Holy Ghost with a personal pronoun, he. In John 16 and verse 13, he. The Holy Spirit has personal traits and emotions. You know, in Ephesians 4 and 30, it says you can grieve the Holy Ghost. Do you know that? The Holy Ghost has intelligence. In Acts 15 and verse 28, it says, for it seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us to lay upon you the greater burden. They were praying about what to do, and the Holy Ghost shows up, and it says, it seemed good to the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost had a say. He had an opinion in what was going on. This is a person. The Holy Ghost has a will. In Acts chapter 16 and verse 6, it says, now when they had gone throughout Persia and the region of Galatia and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia. They were going to take the gospel to Asia, but it wasn't time yet. They were supposed to go the other direction. So the Holy Ghost forbids them. That's because he's a person. He's not a spirit. You getting it? He is a person of the Godhead. He has a will. He has intelligence. He is called personal pronouns. He is a personhood of God. The Holy Ghost is the part of the Trinity that always points to Jesus and to the Father. He never draws attention to himself. Pentecostals need to learn this. The Holy Ghost always points attention to Jesus. In fact, in our text, it said, he will not, when he comes, he will not speak of his own. He will not talk about himself. Jesus talked about himself, and he talked about the Father. God the Father talked to us about himself, and Jesus talked about the Father. But the Holy Ghost always is pointing people to Jesus and to the Father. The Holy Ghost is all about you coming to know Jesus. It's not about himself. Some people call the Holy Ghost the shy part of the Trinity because he never wants to draw attention to himself. He is a gentleman. And so the Holy Ghost has this distinct roles that he plays in the Godhead. Now we've already mentioned that he's the active part of the Trinity, right now here on the earth, carrying out the will of God and the word of Jesus, but there is so much more to the Holy Ghost. And I will talk to you a lot in this series, and this morning we're just kind of skimming the surface to get you started, to get your appetite wet for what's coming. And today I just want to start by giving you three ways that the Holy Spirit is involved in our lives. Three ways, three reasons why you need the Holy Ghost. And the first one is this. In John 14 and verse 16, Jesus first called, in our text, the Holy Spirit, he called the Holy Ghost the Comforter. The Holy Ghost is our Comforter. There are many titles that are given to the Holy Ghost in the New Testament. He's called the Spirit of Truth. He's called the Spirit of Holiness. He's called the Spirit of Life. He's called the Spirit of Adoption. He's called the Spirit of Grace. He's called the Spirit of Glory. He's called the Eternal Spirit. In one verse, he's called the Spirit of Jesus. And there are many symbols for the Holy Spirit. We have the symbol of wind, of fire, of water, of a seal, the symbol of oil. But of all the titles and all the seals, this one is very special and precious to me, one of my favorites. When Jesus said, the Holy Spirit will be your comforter. The Greek word that is used here is, I know you don't know Greek, so just saying this to you to really get a really clear understanding of what Jesus is saying. It's parakletos. And parakletos is a compound word, which means two words formed together to make one. The first word is the Greek word para, or para, and it means alongside, alongside of. And the other word is kaleo, which is the Greek word which means to call or called. And so literally, he is calling the Holy Ghost, one who is called alongside to help us. Isn't that awesome? As a comforter, he's the one who walks alongside us in our life and helps us when things get really difficult and when things get really hard. I'm going to tell you, after I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I've had to go through some difficult times. I've had to preach some funerals of my family, my sister, my father, others that died very young and very close to me. And I've stood in difficult situations many times in my life. And in those situations, people looked at me and said, "How did you do that?" And I said, "I did. It's just the Holy Ghost. I just, in the midst of great storm and turmoil, I find his peace." Doesn't mean things don't get to me. Doesn't mean you don't get overwhelmed. But when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Bible says the Holy Ghost builds up a standard, rises up, and you just feel the strength, and you know where it's coming from. But it's not coming from you. It's coming from him. Amen. You get through. I think just in our own body, a beautiful example is Lisa Bernier. Lisa, I don't want to, she's not here this morning. Good, she won't be embarrassed. Her husband, Peter, is deacon in our church. And, you know, a couple years ago, Lisa, I didn't ask her permission to say this because she would say no. So it's better to give forgiveness than permission. It's easier, hey? Well, Lisa, if you're watching, I love you. Thank you. No, to bring glory to God. And she got a diagnosis of a disease of cancer, and she had to go through treatment after treatment and all this. And we who know her and Pete, we were just like, there's something wrong, because Lisa is acting like she ain't even sick or nothing. It's like nothing's going on. She's got a smile on her face. How's it going? It's going great, you know. How's the chemo going? Oh, no problem. And we're like, what? Something ain't right here, right? One day I just asked Lisa, you know, it's like she went through this whole process and she was just completely, her body's completely rid of all that and healed and praise God. But she had to go through, her and her family went together through a lot of stuff. And you talk to them and it was just like, how are you getting through this? You just seem like things aren't even bothering you, you know. And they're like, God is with us every day. The Holy Spirit is present with me. And I know this stuff is going on, she said, but I just have a peace, Pastor. I just have a peace that everything's going to be all right. That's the comforter. Don't you want that kind of comforter and counselor beside you? That's the comfort of the Holy Ghost. He is our comforter. Secondly, he says, the Holy Ghost is our counselor. Three C words for you to remember this morning. First of all, he's our comforter. Secondly, Jesus said he's our counselor. In verse 13, he said that he will guide you into all truth. When you don't know what to do, the Holy Ghost is there to guide you. He will lead you and give you discernment. He will give you direction when you need it. I was trying to think how I could illustrate this to you. It sounds maybe a little off, but really, I really believe this, because it's been my experience for, you know, like many years. We have a security team at the church, and they do a great job, and they're in the congregation, they're in the building right now, and you don't even know who they are. But the security team, they wear these little things in her ear, little speaker things in her ear, so that they can talk to each other, no matter where they are. If you come in here and they don't know who you are, and you got a big backpack on your back, And you come in the sanctuary. Tall white guy, 6'3", blonde hair, suspicious backpack, aisle 3, seat 4. Watch him. And you don't even know it, you know? And then he's going for the zipper. Keep your eye on him. Get ready. He's going for the zipper. Oh! It's a diaper. It's a diaper. It's okay. We're okay. We're okay. They could talk to each other. You know, somebody's out in the parking lot. I got a car out here. I need you to do this. Or I got a parent coming down. The child is sick. Let them in the hallway. Not supposed to be anybody down there, but you can let it. This is what they look like. This is their name. They're coming down. You know, they could talk to each other, and you don't even know. There's this little voice going on, and they know everything that's going on. And that's the way it is with the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost, when you are baptized in the Holy Ghost, he is there to speak to you and to guide you every single day in everything you're doing. The Holy Ghost talks to me all the time. It's like I got this little thing in my ear saying, go here. I say, Pastor Lane, you need to pray for that person. Okay. I'll go over there. Can I pray for you? And they just start crying, tears coming down their face. What did I say? I was just asking God. I needed somebody to pray for me. Right? That's the Holy Ghost. That's the way he works. Holy Ghost will say, don't say this. You start to say that. Don't say that. That's going to, no, say this instead. Go here. Go there. That's the Holy Ghost. You're looking at me like, you're crazy. I'm telling you. You listen to this. This is just one of many examples. Holly and I were sharing stories. Are you here, Holly? She's downstairs with the kids. We're sharing stories, trying to outdo each other the other day about this. And I stumped her on this one. You know, she couldn't beat this one. Linda and I used to have a radio show in Lexington, Kentucky for marriage, and we were on the way to the radio station to record the program for that week, and I pulled up to the radio station. We were just talking and chatting. And I don't remember what we were talking about. It doesn't matter. We were talking. It was good. And I turned the car off, and the Holy Ghost said to me, be careful when you open the door because there's a poisonous snake there. Now, where would I think something like that, you know, in a parking lot, in the city? Why would I think, you know, this thought's like, obviously, where did that come from, right? I knew exactly where it came from. It was the Holy Ghost. I opened my door. There's a copperhead laying right there where I would have stepped right on him. You think I'm weird? I am weird. I'm telling you, that's not me. That's the Holy Ghost. And you can live that way every single day, my friend. He wants you to live a life where he is guiding you and leading you every single day. Everything you, Pastor Lane, how do you do this? The Holy Spirit, he guides me. He leads me into all truth. I'm telling you, you need the Holy Ghost. Some of you really need the Holy Ghost because I see the decisions you're making. And I ain't the Holy Ghost. I'm just not there. Yeah? And you say, well, you know, Pastor, I don't live that life, and I'm a Christian. I'm a child of God. Isaiah 30, listen to this verse, Isaiah 30, 21, says, whether you turn to the right or to the left, your ears will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. That's a prophecy about the coming of the Spirit of God. Why can't I hear the Holy Ghost like that? How's it going? I don't have one of those Holy Ghost implants in my ear. Well, you know, so many Christians, instead of living a Spirit-filled life, they live a Spirit-less life, a spiritless life. I was really contemplating and praying about this week. I believe that there are two main reasons why a lot of Christians live a Spirit-less life. And the first one the Lord showed me in the scripture is that some Christians aren't even aware about the Holy Ghost. Turn with me to Acts chapter 19. Let's go there, Acts chapter 19. In Acts chapter 19, here's the apostles. Yeah, here I can read it. Acts chapter 19. And they were coming to Ephesus. It was Paul who was with them. It says, verse 1, they arrived at Ephesus, and there they found some disciples and asked them, See, these are disciples. That word means they were followers of Christ, right? They were believers. They heard about Jesus. They've been baptized. And it said, Paul asked them, did you receive the Holy Ghost when you believed? And they answered, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. Paul asked them, then what baptism do you receive? Well, we were baptized under John's baptism. Paul explains to them, well, that was a baptism of repentance. He told the people to believe in the one coming after him, that is in Jesus. And on hearing this, they were baptized in the name of Jesus. So there was something they hadn't heard. First of all, they hadn't heard about Jesus. He tells them about Jesus, that John was a forerunner of Christ. And when they heard about Jesus, they believed on him. They were baptized in his name. And then what happened? That's not the end of it, right? Then Paul placed his hands on them after they were baptized in Jesus' name. And the Holy Spirit came on them. And they heard them speak in tongues and prophesy. The point I want to make is, here were some believers going down the road thinking that they knew what they knew. They had never even heard about the Holy Ghost. And I believe there's a lot of Christians out there that haven't heard about the Holy Ghost. They really haven't. And that's why I'm teaching this. And that's why I hope we have lots of people watch this online. Because the Holy Ghost is real. You need him. It's very real. There's so much more. You became a Christian. You started your faith. You believe in Jesus. There's more anointing for you. There's more. I want to tell you, there's a whole nother dimension to your Christian life that is so far above and beyond where you are right now. And nobody's told you, so I'm telling you this morning, you're welcome. You know, Linda and I just recently, the church, for past appreciation this year, bought us a cruise, a nice Caribbean cruise on Royal Caribbean. Thank you, Royal Caribbean cruise. Now, we have never been on a cruise before, and that's mainly because we always just thought that, you know, cruises were for rich people. And we didn't know a lot about cruises, and number one, and number two, and we're not rich people. You know, we both come from middle-class families. We're middle-class all our life. We're the happy in the middle people, you know? We don't consider ourselves rich people. We don't strive for that. We're just middle-class people, right? So we thought that was like something that, you know, the rich people do or something, you know, it's a little bit excessive. Things we heard about the cruise are a little bit excessive. But we didn't know. And so here the church buys us a cruise. Of course, the second reason why we're never interested in a cruise is because Linda was, you know, afraid of the ocean. You know, the power of the ocean and being on a ship out there with nothing but water. She grew up in North Dakota. Hello. They don't have water there. It's just grass. So the ocean was a scary thing to her. I'm so proud of her that she overcame her fear and got on that ship, man. Yeah, she did. And she did great. It didn't bother her at all. After the first 72 hours or so. No, didn't bother her at all after the first day. She was fine. She was fine. So here's the point. We went on this ship, and we discovered, listen, folks, and many of you have been on cruises. Maybe some of you haven't been on cruises. I want to tell you something. Rich people live on a whole different level. And I didn't know. Yeah, I didn't know. We were treated like, oh, my goodness, talk about Royal Caribbean, royal treatment. I'm not here to do a plug for Royal Caribbean. Sounds like I am. But we got the Royal. I mean, when you sit down to eat, they take their napkin and they put the napkin in your lap. They're dipping it off of you and pouring it. And this is everything, whatever you want, you need. It's just like everything. You can have whatever you want to eat, whenever you want to eat it, all day, in the evening, it don't matter. There's a buffet, there's smorgasbord, there's fancy food, things you can't even name, and it's all there for you. Luxury. The rich, man, they are living at a whole different level when it comes to food. And they're living at a whole different level when it comes to being served and waited on. I mean, let me tell you, they take our towels in the bathroom and make animals out of them. Hang them from the ceiling. There's a bat. That's my towel. Give me that towel. I mean, you know, you come and let me give you a free massage. And just, you're so okay. If you have to. I mean, just, you know, just like, we didn't realize. It's like, we were so uncomfortable, honestly. We got used to it after a few days. At first, it was like, oh, let me serve you, because we're used to serving people, not being served, right? That's our job, to serve. That's our calling, to serve people. So it was really awkward for us. But, you know, it's like, man, we got to go on another cruise real soon. It's like, these people are living at a whole different level. We never knew that life could be this plush, you know? And that's the same way it is for the children of God. Those who are baptized in the Holy Ghost, they are able to experience a whole different way of living. It is so much better. It is so much more. It really is. And so if you haven't heard, now you've heard. Don't you want more of the Holy Ghost? Of course you do. Because I told you it was like better than being with rich people. The other reason, though, that some people don't experience the Holy Ghost is that they resist. Some Christians resist the Holy Ghost. I turn to Acts chapter 7. Acts chapter 7. Stephen was preaching strong. He was naming sin. He was going after it. And he was speaking to the, I believe it was the Sadducees. No, it was the Sanhedrin. In verse 51, he says to them, and he's just talking to these religious leaders. They were fixing to stone him. They're fixing to kill him. He was talking about Jesus. He was fanatical. He was on fire for God. Revival was taking place. People being healed, delivered, set free, saved. Revival, the whole city was being changed. The devil didn't like it. He comes against them. Who to use? Religious people. He says, you stiff-necked people with uncircumcised hearts and ears, you are just like your father. You always resist the Holy Spirit. See that? These are people who are supposed to be God followers, but they resisted the Holy Spirit. And a lot of Christians resist the Holy Spirit. What does that mean? When the Holy Spirit speaks to you and prompts you to do something, like, I want you to go over there and pray for Nate. But God, you know, every time I pray for Nate, he gets all emotional and makes a scene, and it's, I don't want to do that. He doesn't do that. But I say, no, I've resisted the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit says, I want you to do this. I want you to give your paycheck to Lighthouse Church this week because they really need some extra help. I'm going to use you. You don't need that money. Your bills are paid, so I'm going to let you pay for the bills for the church this week. And you're like, no, not going to do it. I'm going on a cruise next month. Right? So you're like, no, right? That's resisting the Holy Spirit. Or when the Holy Spirit convicts you about something and tells you something that you are doing that you're not supposed to do, like maybe you're watching that TV show and there's a scene that comes on there that is very ungodly, and the Holy Spirit speaks to you and says, you need to change the channel. And you're like, just a minute, Holy Ghost, just a minute. And you don't do it. You need to forgive that person. You need to go and tell them. You need to make up with that person. You've offended them. No, I'm not going to do that. The Holy Spirit convicts you. You say no. That's resisting him. That's saying no to God. And when you resist the Holy Ghost, you know what happens? You keep resisting him. It gets easier. It gets easier. Some of you, when you first became a Christian, you used to watch certain TV shows and things, and when you watched it, it was like, I can't watch this. What am I doing watching this, right? I can't go to the bar. You go to the bar, it's like, oh, wait a minute, I'm not supposed to be here. This is my old crew, my old crowd. I used to get drunk here. I'm this isn't a good testimony for me. I don't need to be here. But you stayed anyway. And you stayed next time. And the Holy Spirit's like, no, you shouldn't be here. No, you shouldn't be here. No, you shouldn't watch that. And then the voice became less and less and less. And pretty soon you don't hear his voice anymore at all. Your heart is hardened. I'm talking to some people here this morning in this room that the Holy Spirit used to speak to you. You wonder why you don't hear from the Holy Spirit. It's because you have resisted him. The Holy Spirit, I said, is a gentleman. He's not going to stay where he's not wanted. If you push him away, he'll stay away. He loves you, but if you don't want him in your life, he'll let you live your life without him. Don't resist the Holy Spirit. It's a little quiet in here. And leads me to my final point this morning, if the worship team will come up. The third thing that Jesus said the Holy Spirit will do is he will be the convictor. Not only the comforter, not only the guide, the counselor, he'll tell you what to do, be with you every day. But you know what? He is also the convictor. What does it mean to be convicted of the Holy Spirit? Conviction is when you feel guilty about what you are doing. It's when the Holy Spirit says, what you're doing is wrong and you shouldn't do this. That's conviction. It's not condemnation. The Holy Spirit never condemns you. He never says to you, you're a bad person. That's the devil. The Holy Spirit doesn't say you're a bad person. He says what you're doing is bad and you need to change, because he wants you to be a good person. And the only way we can have any goodness is God's goodness, because our righteousness is his filthy rags, right? And so the Holy Spirit convicts us. Why does he do that? Because he is wanting us to be like Jesus. He is wanting us to be set free and delivered from the sin that so easily, Paul said, holds us back like a weight around us, keeps us from moving forward. Let me tell you, the Holy Ghost wants you to live an abundant life full of power and anointing. He has fruit beyond measure for you. And when you are resisting and when you are involved in sin, the Holy Ghost checks your heart and says, this is not right. It's hindering you. You know, let's stand to our feet across the congregation. Please stand to your feet with me, please. When you go to the airport to get on the airplane, anywhere in the United States, you go to a major airport and you're going to have to go through security, right? You go through security, you have to take your belt off, you got to take everything out of your pocket, you got to put your bags that you're carrying on the plane through the x-ray machine. And then you go through a big scanning machine yourself, and you put your feet on the yellow things, you know, put your hands up like this, and it goes. On the other side, it shows things that they cannot see. It shows things that are underneath that may be dangerous. That guy is looking at the x-ray machine for things in your baggage that do not belong on the plane. And if they find them in there, they'll pull you aside and take it out and say, you can't have this on the plane. What do you want us to do? And there's a garbage can right there. You know, what are you going to say? Right? That's what the Holy Spirit does as a convictor. He sees what people can't see. You start playing, if you would, please. He sees on the outside, what he sees on the inside, things that people don't see on the outside. He sees the sin. He sees the bad thoughts. He sees the attitude and the motive of our heart. He sees the lust. He sees the greed. He sees the pride, the motive. He sees on the inside. And God wants to take you places, but listen, you're not going to get on that plane with baggage that's going to hold you back. And so the Holy Spirit convicts us because he wants us to go to our destination. And there are things in our life that will keep us from there. And so before we get on that plane, the Holy Ghost says, you need to deal with this in your life. You've got pride here. You've got lust here. You've got greed here. You've got unforgiveness here. You know you shouldn't be doing this. You know you shouldn't be doing that, but you keep doing it. The Holy Spirit shows us these things. It's not man, it's God that shows you. It's God that's speaking to you. It's the Holy Ghost. He's the convictor. I don't know what kind of altar call you were expecting today, but I know I was expecting that the Holy Ghost is going to be here. He's going to be convicting some hearts today. That's why I preach a lot about Jesus. That's why I talk about the Holy Spirit, because people say, well, why don't you get up here and start listing the sins? You know there's people in your church involved in all these sins. Yeah, I know. I'm the shepherd. I know. But nothing's going to change for me talking to them. But if the Holy Ghost talks to them, maybe they'll listen. In Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, Peter stood up and preached a sermon. The whole town was there to hear it. Thousands of people, literally 3,000 of them got saved right there in that crowd. That's how many people were there. He preached, he said, Jesus, who you crucified, God has made both Lord and King. And the Bible says that they were cut to their heart. That's the conviction of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit got a hold of their heart, squeezed it, and said, you have crucified the Messiah. And the Spirit was so convicting them that they cried out and said, what must we do? And Peter said, verse 37, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus, and you shall receive the Holy Ghost. You want the Holy Ghost? The first step is not come to the altar. The first step is not let Pastor Lane lay hands on you. No. The first step is always repentance. Repent and be baptized. Make a transformation. Make a change. Then he said, the promise of the Holy Ghost is for you, your children, your children's children, everybody as far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. The Holy Ghost baptism is here for everybody. But before you get there, you've got to repent of your sins. You got to repent. Everybody bow your head. Please, no looking around. This is a sacred moment right now. I've been fasting and praying this week that the Holy Spirit would work on the hearts of people in this room today and those watching online, that when they hear this word, that they will open themselves up for the Holy Spirit to do a scan on them. And I just dare you right now to ask him. The psalmist David once wrote a psalm, and in this prayer he said, search me, O Lord, and see if there be any wicked way in me. Why did he pray that prayer? Because he knew he wanted Jesus. He wanted God so much, right? And he knew that sin would keep him from what God had for him. And so sometimes there's even things in our heart that we don't even know that are there. David knew this, so he asked for God's Holy Spirit to search him, to scan him. Put me in your x-ray machine. Right now, will you dare to pray that prayer and say, Holy Spirit, I ask you today to examine my heart, see my thoughts. And I know what I'm feeling right now is that some of you are just kicking back on that and you're saying, wait a minute, there's thoughts I have. I don't want God to see them. He already sees them. He knows what's in your hidden closet. He knows what's there. He's God. But don't worry. He loves you in spite of that dark spot, that dark place in your life. He loved you and died on a cross to set you free from that. Will you do that right now? Just say, Holy Spirit, examine me. Is there anything in my life right now? Is there anything I'm doing? Is there any attitude I have? Is there any relationship? Is there any thoughts that I need to repent of? Repent doesn't mean I'm sorry. Repent doesn't mean, yeah, I did it. It's not confession. Confession is where we begin, but repentance is turning from it. It's turning away from it. The Holy Spirit's saying to you, you know what? You're going down to the bar on Friday and you're drinking with these guys and they're having dirty jokes and there's bad things going. You need to stop doing that. Repentance is not saying, okay, yeah, I hear you. I'm sorry. I shouldn't be doing that, God. Repentance is, God, forgive me. I am not going back to that bar again. In Jesus' name, you're going to give me the power to say no every time. I am not going to do it. And you ask God to help you. Repentance is not, yeah, God, I know I have a problem with my mouth. And, you know, sometimes I just let these terrible things, I curse you with my mouth and different things come out of my mouth. And I know it grieves the Holy Spirit, but I just confess that, God. No, that's not repentance. That's just confession. You got to confess that. And you got to say, God, I give my tongue to the Holy Ghost. Instead of speaking blessings, I'm going to let him just take over and speak only blessings instead of cursings. I'm going to speak only blessings in my life. My tongue is going to be used to heal and to build up people and not to tear down. And you need to surrender your tongue to the Holy Ghost. That's right. Boy, I just felt that when I said it. I guess that's a funny image in my head. Some of you need to come and lay your tongue on the altar. That's what I saw. I saw people coming up and putting their tongue on the altar. Don't do that literally, okay? But I just, crazy stuff. Right now, Holy Spirit. So this is how we're going to end the service. I know the men are going to meet right over here on this side. They're going to meet in the back when we're done. But listen, there's donuts downstairs. We have donuts back. Fellowship downstairs. There's prayer tonight at 6 o'clock. There's an A-team meeting at 5 for people who want to pray on the altar. But listen, right now, this is the moment. Right now, don't miss this. The Holy Ghost is here. And he wants to examine you. Not so he can point out your weaknesses. Not so he can say, you got sin. No, but so that he can deliver you, so that he can set you free, so that he can heal you completely of your sins, and that you can walk out of here with freedom and victory, so that you can live that next level of life in the Spirit. Life in the Spirit is walking by faith and not by sight. It's walking in the supernatural. Have you this morning resisted the Holy Ghost? Have you turned away from his voice to where you don't hear it anymore? Guess what? God says, this morning, if you'll repent of your sin, if you will ask me, I will heal you of your sin, and I will speak to you in ways you've never known before. That's what God wants to do. So the worship team's going to sing a song. I'm not going to come back to the pulpit. This is it right here. I'm dismissing you, but as this worship team comes to sing, if you are here this morning and the Holy Spirit is convicting you, there's some things that you need to repent of, I'm going to ask you to make a beeline to the altar. Get on your knees before God in a humble position and say, forgive me, God. Help me to change. He will give you the power to do what you cannot do for yourself. Holy Spirit, examine me right now. Right now, across the room, Holy Spirit of God. Holy Ghost, right now, will you just begin to convict? I guess it's not the work of man, this is the work of God. You know, God, early this morning, I was repenting. Early this morning, I was asking you to examine me. I couldn't get up here and preach. If there's anything in my heart or in my life that would keep you from using me today, God. I pray that same for every person in this chair, every chair in this room right now, God. Holy Ghost, as we sing, if you need to pray, the altar is open. If you need to leave, leave quietly. Don't talk till you get outside, because people are dealing with their hearts this morning. Nobody's going to come and lay hands on you this morning. This is between you and God. This is between you and God, the Holy Ghost. Speaking to you. You need to change. You need
to
repent.
There's a place when the heart is under fire.
Jesus.
Another way when the walls are closing. Another in the fire, standing next to me. There is another in the waters, holding back the sea. Should I ever need reminded of how I've been set free? There is a cross that bears the burden, where another died for me. There is another in the fire. I know I'll never be alone.
joy, come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. Chains are gonna fall.
Jesus, you changed everything.
just your glory in wondering surrender. We fall down. Show us your glory. Show us your glory. Let every bird.